Assalamu alaikum. This is Dr. Sadia Mirza, and I will be discussing vitamin D, the second fat soluble vitamin, today in the lecture. So first of all, we need to know that this D vitamins are a group of sterols that have a hormone-like function. Their active molecule is 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol. This active vitamin D, it binds to intracellular receptor proteins, and then all the functions are done. The 1,25-dihydroxy receptor complex, this interacts with DNA in the nucleus of target cells in a manner similar to that of vitamin A. I discussed the mechanism of action of vitamin A, where this retinol converts into retinoic acid and goes and binds to the DNA. So in a similar manner, vitamin D also interacts with DNA in the nucleus of target cells, and then the functions are done. The most prominent action of vitamin D are to regulate the plasma levels of calcium and phosphorus. Distribution of vitamin D. So endogenous. Actually, your skin, dermis and epidermis, it has an intermediate product that is 7-dehydrocholesterol, which is an intermediate in cholesterol synthesis. Okay, this 7-dehydrocholesterol is converted to cholecalciferol once exposed to sunlight. When a person is exposed to sunlight, this 7-dehydrocholesterol is converted to cholecalciferol. This cholecalciferol is transported to liver bound to vitamin D binding protein. So once it is gone into the liver, then its activation takes place, which I will be discussing later. So diet, ergocalciferol, which is vitamin D2, this is found in plants, and cholecalciferol, which is vitamin D3, this is found in animal tissues. Ergocalciferol and cholecalciferol, they differ chemically only in the presence of an additional double bond and methyl group in the plant sterol. Dietary vitamin D is packaged into chylomicrons. Preformed vitamin D is a dietary requirement only in individuals with limited exposure to sunlight. So this is the structure. You can see the double bonds and the methyl group. Dietary sources. Fish, liver oil is the richest source of vitamin D. Egg yolk, margarine, lard, this also has fair amount of vitamin D. Some quantity is also present in butter and cheese. Ergosterol is widely distributed in plants, but it is not absorbed well, so it does not have a good nutritional importance or value. Calciferol is readily absorbed. Recommended dietary allowance, about 100 international units or 2.5 microgram of vitamin D3 is the daily requirement in an adult man. You know, pregnant and lactating mothers always need more vitamin as compared to a person who is not pregnant or lactating. So the pregnant and lactating mothers, as well as infants and children, they require about 220 international units per day. Breast milk is a poor source supplementation recommended for breast babies. So breast milk is a poor source, so supplementation for children who are on breastfeed is recommended for those children. Intestinal absorption. Like most other fat-soluble vitamins, bile salts help in absorption of vitamin D from small intestine. After absorption, it is carried in chylomicron droplets of the lymph in combination with serum globulin in blood plasma. So, formation of 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol. Vitamin D2 and D3 are not biologically active, but are converted into vivo to the active form of the D vitamin by two sequential hydroxylation reactions. So initially I told you that you have dihydrocholesterol in your body that is converted into cholecalciferol. This cholecalciferol is sent to liver, and the first hydroxylation occurs in the liver at position 25. And this reaction is catalyzed by a specific 25 hydroxylase which is present in the liver. I'll show the diagram also. And once this hydroxylation takes place, the product is 25 hydroxycholecalciferol. And it is the predominant form of vitamin D in plasma and the major storage form of vitamin. 25 hydroxycholecalciferol is further hydroxylated at the one position by 25 hydroxycholecalciferol 1 hydroxylase, which is present in the kidney, resulting in the formation of 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol. So you need two hydroxylations, one hydroxylation in the liver at 25th position and second hydroxylation in the kidney by one hydroxylase at first position. So one hydroxylase as well as the liver 25 hydroxylase enzyme are cytochrome P450 proteins. So this is the diagram you see here. 7-dehydrocholesterol, light falls on the skin, 7-dehydrocholesterol is converted into cholecalciferol. This cholecalciferol bound to a protein comes to the liver. Now this is the storage form. Cholecalciferol is hydroxylated at 25th position by 25 hydroxylase, and the product you get is 25 hydroxycholecalciferol. This is actually the storage form. Now 25-hydroxycholecalciferol is sent to kidney for another hydroxylation by 1 hydroxylase, and thus 25-hydroxycholecalciferol is converted into 125-dihydroxycholecalciferol, which is the activated vitamin D. 1 hydroxylase is the enzyme which is doing the hydroxylation here, and low phosphate and parathyroid hormone are the activators of 1 hydroxylase. Okay, so if there is low phosphate, if there is parathyroid hormone present in a fair amount, 1 hydroxylase is activated and this activation takes place. But when there is fair amount of activated vitamin D, this will inhibit 1 hydroxylase. This is like a self inhibition. It will inhibit 1 hydroxylase, thus stopping this conversion. Okay. I'm gonna tell you how this is gonna work when vitamin D gets activated. So this is what I told you, that there is regulation of hydroxylase. 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol is the most potent vitamin D metabolite. Its formation is tightly regulated by the level of plasma phosphate and calcium. 25 hydroxycholecalciferol 1 hydroxylase activity is increased directly by low plasma phosphate, indirectly by low plasma calcium, which triggers secretion of PTH from the chief cells of the parathyroid gland. Parathyroid upregulates the 1 hydroxylase, as I told you. 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol inhibits the synthesis of PTH, forming a negative feedback loop. It also inhibits the activity of 1 hydroxylase. Function of vitamin D. The overall function of vitamin D is to maintain adequate plasma levels of calcium by increasing uptake of calcium by the intestine. I'll show you in the diagram. 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol enters the intestinal cell and binds to a cytosolic receptor. the 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol receptor complex then moves to the nucleus, where it selectively interacts with response elements on the DNA. As a result, calcium uptake is enhanced by an increased synthesis of a specific calcium binding protein, calbindin. So this mechanism is typical of steroid hormone. Number two, by minimizing the loss of calcium by the kidney by increasing the reabsorption. Number three, stimulating resorption or demineralization of bone when blood calcium is low. So vitamin D stimulates the mobilization of calcium from the bone by a process that requires protein synthesis and the presence of PTH. The result is an increase in plasma calcium and phosphate. Therefore, bone is an important reservoir of calcium that can be mobilized to maintain plasma levels. PTH and calcitriol also work together to prevent renal loss of calcium. First, I'm going to show you the diagram here. Yeah, this one. So once this activated vitamin D comes to the intestinal cell, it goes into the nucleus and gene transcription takes place. Then there is messenger RNA. Then there is a translation which produces proteins, which is calbindin. And this calcium binding protein, it binds calcium from the intestinal cell and brings it back into the plasma. Here, if when serum calcium is low, and when serum calcium is low, it also helps resorption of bone by demineralization of this bone and bringing this calcium to the plasma so that the plasma levels of calcium are normalized. Okay, this is the whole thing. Then we'll go to the other flow chart here. So plasma calcium when low, okay, parathyroid hormone is increased. When parathyroid hormone is increased, this is gonna mobilize calcium from bone, renal reabsorption of calcium, and it is gonna decrease the excretion of calcium, and it is increasing calcium absorption from intestine. So ultimately you have increased plasma calcium. The active vitamin D3, the parathyroid hormone is not gonna do anything in the intestine. The activated vitamin D3 is going to mobilize the calcium from bone. It is going to increase the renal reabsorption of calcium and decrease its excretion. And this vitamin D is going to increase the calcium absorption from the intestine. Okay. So parathyroid has nothing to do with the intestinal calcium. Right. So these procedures are going to increase the plasma calcium. So, the deficiency diseases related to vitamin D, this is mainly rickets. There are nutritional rickets, vitamin D resistant rickets, vitamin D dependent rickets, which are of different types. So what happens is vitamin D deficiency causes a net demineralization of bone, resulting in rickets in children and osteomalacia in adults. Rickets characterized by the continued formation of collagen matrix of bone but incomplete mineralization. So this process results in soft pliable bones. There will be bone tenderness, muscle weakness, increased tendency for fractures like easily broken bones, especially green stick fractures, skeletal deformity. Like in toddlers, you may have bowed legs, you may have knock knees, and there is cranial deformity such as skull bossing or delayed fontanelle closure. There could be spinal deformity such as kyphoscoliosis or lumbar lordosis. So wrist x-ray shows changes in rickets, mainly cupping is seen, and there is hypocalcemia, and due to hypocalcemia you have tetany, which is muscle spasm all over the body, especially the hands. Craniotabes, that means soft skull. Then there is costochondral swelling, which is also known as rickety rosary. And there's Harrison groove and pigeon chest, which is also known as pectus carinatum. I'm going to show you the pictures also. So osteomalacia in adults means demineralization of pre-existing bones increase the susceptibility to fracture. And there's insufficient exposure to daylight or deficiency in vitamin D consumption occurs predominantly in infants and the elderly. There are two types of vitamin D dependent rickets. There's type 1 and then there's type 2. So type 1 is due to 1-alpha hydroxylase deficiency. So there is a defect in the conversion of 25 hydroxycholecalciferol to 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol. In type 2, there's a single amino acid change in one of the zinc fingers of the DNA binding sites for receptors. So this makes the receptors non-functional and thus you cannot have active vitamin D working. Then there is renal osteodystrophy. In this, there is chronic kidney disease. In people with chronic kidney disease, there is decreased ability to form active vitamin D as well as increased retention of phosphate causing hyperphosphatemia and hypocalcemia. The low blood calcium causes a rise in parathyroid hormone and associated bone demineralization with release of calcium and phosphate. Supplementation with calcitriol is effective in this therapy. Toxicity of vitamin D. So high doses like 100,000 international units for weeks or months can cause loss of appetite, nausea, thirst, and stupor. Enhanced calcium absorption and bone resorption results in hypercalcemia, which can lead to deposition of calcium in many organs, particularly the arteries and kidney. The upper limit is 100 milligram per day or 4,000 international units per day for individual aged 9 years or older, with a lower level for those under age 9. See, these are bowed legs of a middle-aged man. Knock knees, bowed legs. Bowed legs. This is a family with a child who is normal, then there are knock knees and then there are bowed legs. This is showing the widening, cupping of the wrist. This is showing fraying and splaying or transverse widening of the metaphysis here. So this is showing you the dwarfing, craniotabes, that means soft skull, there is pigeon chest, then there is rickety rosary, the prominent costochondral junctions, these bead-like structures, Harrison groove, here's the groove, and then there is bowing of the leg, there may be knock knees, yeah, dekho, this is clearer, this is craniotabes or soft skull, rickety rosary, all these bead-like structures. Then there's Harrison groove. This occurs due to pulling of the softened ribs by the diaphragm during inspiration. So here you have this Harrison groove. This is rickety rosy. This is C. You can see the costochondral junctions so clearly like beads. Pigeon chest. Pigeon chest. Here. So, we'll be ending this vitamin D, and here I told you about the sources of vitamin D, the mechanism of action, its functions, its deficiency diseases, and its toxicity. Hopefully you understood, and next time we'll be talking about vitamin K. Thank you very much.